Hello students, today we are reading the ciliary ganglia. So we'll discuss the anatomy and connections of this ciliary ganglia. Now when we'll talk about the parasympathetic supply, we have the four ganglias. One is the ciliary ganglia, pterygopalatine ganglia, otic ganglia and submandibular ganglia. Now when we are talking about the parasympathetic ganglias, there are two important parts that we have already discussed in the earlier classes, that it is having the preganglionic part and the postganglionic part. Now the preganglionic part comes from the nuclei which are present in the brain, and these all are known as general visceral efferent component of the cranial nerve. Now when you will have the parasympathetic supply, it is known as craniosacral outflow. So the sacral component of spinal cord, that is S2, S3, S4, is also responsible for the parasympathetic supply. So today we'll discuss this ciliary ganglia, which is a parasympathetic ganglia and it is related with the third cranial nerve. So it is a peripheral parasympathetic ganglia, and there are two things which we always have in the parasympathetic ganglias, that is topographic relation and the functional relation. Now when we will talk about the ciliary ganglia functionally related with the oculomotor nerve, that means third cranial nerve, but topographically it is supported by the nasociliary nerve, and nasociliary nerve is a branch of ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve. So whenever you are reading any kind of the parasympathetic ganglia, you always keep in mind that there are two things. One is the fibers, those are parasympathetic and they are going to relay in this ganglia, is the meaning of functional relation. That means the oculomotor nerve carries the preganglionic fibers and they will relay into the ganglia, while the nasociliary nerve is not carrying any kind of parasympathetic fibers to the ganglia. Then it contains the multipolar neurons. So this is again the important question for your exam. Then what is the location of ciliary ganglia? Ciliary ganglia is a very small ganglia which is 2 mm in diameter, and it lies near the apex of orbit. Now in the apex you will have the two structure. One is the optic nerve and second is the lateral rectus. So it is a sandwich structure between these two. Now in this diagram you can appreciate that this is your nerve. Now this is your optic nerve, and just lateral to the optic nerve you will have the ciliary ganglia, which is inside the lateral rectus muscle. So you have to first identify the lateral rectus, which is here, and this is your optic nerve, and in between them you will have this ganglia which is known as ciliary ganglia. So this is very commonly asked question in your exam, what is the position of ciliary ganglia. So it is a structure between the lateral rectus and optic nerve. Then what are the roots or the connections of this ciliary ganglia? So whenever we are having the ganglia, generally you will have the three roots, like motor root, sensory root and sympathetic root. But here you have to understand the one and most important thing is that in ciliary ganglia, generally the sympathetic root is highly variable, and sometimes it receives only the two branches or two roots. Then in this diagram you can see this is your eyeball, and this eyeball is receiving the parasympathetic supply, sympathetic supply and sensory supply. Now this is your ciliary ganglia. Now this ciliary ganglia is having the posteriorly placed three roots. This is the first root, this is the second root, and here is the third root. Now what are the name of these roots? This is the first root, which is sensory root. Then you will have the second root, which is sympathetic root, and this is the third root, which is parasympathetic root. So all the roots are attached on the posterior side of the ganglia, and anterior side you will have this structure which is known as short ciliary nerve, which is the only branch of ciliary ganglia. Now what is about the motor root? So motor root derived from nerve to inferior oblique. Now this is the first question for your exam. Now the meaning of nerve to inferior oblique means that we know all the muscles of eyeball, that means the extra ocular muscles of eyeball supplied by the third cranial nerve, except superior oblique and lateral rectus, which is supplied by the fourth and sixth cranial nerve respectively. Now here you have to understand this concept that when you are talking about the third cranial nerve, it is going to supply your remaining extraocular muscle. Now the nerve is carrying the parasympathetic fibers, and these fibers will go and relay into the ciliary ganglia by approaching its branch, which is known as nerve to inferior oblique. And when this nerve to inferior oblique will go downward, it will give a branch which ultimately go and relay into your ciliary ganglia. Because you are having the different branches from the oculomotor nerve, like it is supplying your superior rectus, it is supplying your medial rectus. So this is the important thing, that this branch, that is your parasympathetic root, is passing from this third cranial nerve to the inferior oblique, not to the superior rectus or other recti which are supplied by the your oculomotor nerve. So this is the important thing, which is a very commonly asked question. Now the second thing is, which I told you, that it is carrying the preganglionic fibers. So what is the source of preganglionic fiber? The source of preganglionic fiber is Edinger Westphal nucleus. Now this nucleus is actually the collection of neuron inside the midbrain, and that is considered as a preganglionic parasympathetic nuclei for oculomotor nerve. Now the fibers, those are arising from Edinger Westphal nucleus, ultimately relay into this ciliary ganglia, and from the ciliary ganglia your post ganglionic fibers arises after the synapses. Now these post ganglionic fibers, which are arising from the neurons of this ganglia, pass through the short ciliary nerve. So this is again the question for your exam, that what is the name of connection between the ciliary ganglia and eyeball? Answer is short ciliary nerve. And this short ciliary nerve ultimately give parasympathetic supply to the two structures. One is ciliaris muscle and second is in sphincter pupillae. So you have to understand that there are intraocular muscles also, and those intraocular muscles are supplied by autonomic nervous system. So what are the name of intraocular muscle? Like ciliaris muscle and in sphincter pupillae, which are supplied by parasympathetic supply. Now in these two diagram you can understand that this is showing the cranial component. Now here you can see that this is the midbrain. In the midbrain you will have the nuclei which are known as Edinger Westphal nucleus. Now this Edinger Westphal nucleus is a nuclei of midbrain, and it is giving the fibers, those are known as preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, and these fibers are reaching to the ciliary ganglia by oculomotor nerve. That's why oculomotor nerve is known as functional nerve, or functionally the ciliary ganglia related with oculomotor nerve. Now this is your ciliary ganglia where these fibers are going to relay, and from here you will have the short ciliary nerve, and this short ciliary nerve ultimately enters into the eyeball to supply the ciliary muscle and in sphincter pupillae muscle. Now in this diagram you can see that this is what is your nerve. Now this nerve is here making a synapse. Now this nerve is nerve to inferior oblique. What is that? Nerve to inferior oblique. So the motor fibers will go to the target, that is inferior oblique, and it is giving one small branch which is having the parasympathetic supply, and that ultimately will go and make synapse with these neuron. From here you have the postganglionic fibers arising, and these fibers are passing through this nerve, which is known as short ciliary nerve. So there are two things which are important for exam purpose. One is nerve to inferior oblique, and second is short ciliary nerve. Now what is the effect of parasympathetic in the eye? Now whenever you have the stimulation of sphincter pupillae, as the name itself suggesting, it acts like in sphincter, so it decreases the diameter of the pupil and you will have the meiosis. Second thing is that it is also supplying the ciliaris muscle. Now this ciliaris muscle is responsible to change the shape of the lens. Now when you require the lens shape changes, when you need more convexity, and that more convexity is provided by the contraction of ciliaris muscle, and this is responsible for the near vision at the time of accommodation. Now What about the second route? That is known as sensory route. Now, sensory route is carrying the sensations from the eyeball. Now, this actually derived from the nasociliary nerve. Now, as we know that ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve is a pure sensory division. So, the nasociliary nerve carries the sense from the eye and it consists of the fibers. Those are responsible for the pain, touch and temperature from the eyeball. This root fibers pass through the ciliary ganglia but without relay. Why without relay? Because I just told you that whatever the neurons are present in the ciliary ganglia, synapse only with the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers. So in this diagram, you can appreciate again that this fiber, this root is your sympathetic root, this root is your sensory root, and this root is your parasympathetic root. Now here what you can see that the sensory fibers, those are entering into the nasociliary nerve and they will take the sense of touch, pain, temperature to the brain, can reach by two pathways. One, you can see that they are passing without entering through the ganglia. Second, the fibers are passing through the ganglia and they are approaching to the nasociliary nerve. So there are two things which you have to understand always, that whenever the fibers or the connection between the ganglia and the eyeball, it is always through the short ciliary nerve. But if there is a bypass of this ganglia, then it is another name comes as long ciliary nerve. So here you are able to understand that sensory fibers from eye to the nasociliary nerve can reach by two routes. One is directly through the nasociliary nerve and second is they are passing through the short ciliary, coming out from the ganglia without interruption and ultimately become the part of nasociliary nerve. So we are talking about this part and this is known as sensory route of your ganglia. Then you will have the third route, which is the sympathetic route, and I already told you that sympathetic route is highly variable because sometimes it is absent. Now it is derived from the sympathetic plexus around the internal carotid artery. As we know that the sympathetic fibers arises from the T1 spinal segment and then they will enter into the spinal trunk by the white rami communicans. They ascend till the superior cervical ganglia. Now in the superior cervical ganglia, these fibers from the T1 sympathetic segment will relay. So the source of sympathetic supply is T1 and the postganglionic fibers arises from superior cervical ganglia. So the superior cervical ganglia is the source of sympathetic supply for your eyeball. So this is the important thing. And what is the source? Answer is T1. So the fibers from superior cervical ganglia make a plexus around the internal carotid artery and the fibers pass through the ganglia without relay. So this is again the important thing, that these fibers are also passing through the ciliary ganglia without relay, because ciliary ganglia consists of the parasympathetic neuron, not the sympathetic neuron. And these are the postganglionic sympathetic fibers. Those are arising from superior cervical ganglia of the sympathetic chain. Now the fibers further pass through the short ciliary nerve. So now here again the short ciliary nerve comes in the picture. That is, I told you that whenever you are having the name short ciliary nerve, you should have this image in the mind that the short ciliary nerve is a connection between the ciliary ganglia and eyeball. Now this is the only thing which you always keep in mind, that short ciliary nerve means the connection between eyeball and ciliary ganglia. And this short ciliary nerve is containing all the three root fiber. That means the fibers which are going to supply sensory area or the parasympathetic or the sympathetic, all the three are passing through the short ciliary nerve. So the important thing here is that the sympathetic supply is to which structure? Answer is dilator pupillae and blood vessels. So here you now realize that there are three intraocular muscles. One is in sphincter pupillae, another is ciliary muscle, and third is dilator pupillae. So dilator pupillae is supplied by the sympathetic, while the sphincter pupillae and ciliary muscle is supplied by the parasympathetic nerves. So what is the alternate of sympathetic route? What does it mean? That how the sympathetic fibers can approach the eyeball without passing through the ganglia. Because we are saying this, that the sympathetic route is highly variable or it may absent sometime. So what will happen in this case, that sympathetic fibers to the eyeball may not enter the ganglia as a separate sympathetic route. So sometimes you will find that you don't have the sympathetic route. In that case, rather the postganglionic sympathetic fibers leave the plexus around the artery that is associated with the internal carotid artery in the cavernous sinus, and these fibers in the cavernous sinus joins the ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve. So if the fibers join the ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve, then what will happen, that these fibers course into the ciliaris ganglia in sensory route from the nasociliary nerve. What does it mean? Suppose this is your ciliaris ganglia and this is your eyeball. Now what will happen, that you have this short ciliary nerve. Now I told you that this ganglia is having the three root, but here we are talking about only the two root. The sympathetic root is absent. Now what will happen, that there is a sensory root. Suppose this is your sensory root. Now the fibers those are present in the sensory root are actually the fibers of nasociliary nerve. So the sensory fibers are passing through the sensory root into the nasociliary nerve. Now this nasociliary nerve is also having the sympathetic fibers. Those are coming into this nasociliary nerve from the ophthalmic nerve, and ophthalmic nerve receiving these fibers from the plexus around the internal carotid artery. So these fibers are approaching the eyeball through this sensory route, and then they are passing through this ganglia without relay or without any interruption. So in this way you can see now that there are only two routes. This is parasympathetic route and this is sympathetic route. Now this sympathetic route and sensory route become common, and parasympathetic route is carrying preganglionic fiber. Those will relay here, and then you will have the postganglionic fiber. So the short ciliary nerve is still having all the three variety. It is having the sensory fiber, it is having the postganglionic sympathetic, and it is having the postganglionic parasympathetic. So this is the one way that if the sympathetic route is absent, then the fibers may join the sensory route to approach the eyeball. Now there is a one more way, that in addition, the sympathetic fibers carried the nasociliary nerve may not enter the ganglia. What does it mean? Now suppose if we will remove this sympathetic part. Now in this case, what will happen, that now the ganglia is here, but the sympathetic fibers are not approaching through the ganglia, and these fibers are approaching directly to the eyeball. Now if this is happening, then it is not short ciliary nerve, because I told you that short ciliary nerve means the connection between the ganglia and eyeball. But if the fibers are approaching to the eyeball directly without ciliary ganglia, then is it a short ciliary nerve? Answer is no, it is a long ciliary nerve. So this is the important thing which you have to understand, that in addition, the sympathetic fibers carried the nasociliary nerve may not enter the ganglia. So these fibers are not entering the ganglia at all and may course directly into the eyeball in long ciliary nerve. Clear? So now you have to be clear in your mind that the nerves those are approaching to the eyeball can be the short ciliary nerve or long ciliary nerve. If the sympathetic fibers are approaching directly without ganglia, then it has to be through the long ciliary nerve. Or if the sympathetic fiber approaching the eyeball through the ganglia, then it has to be through the short ciliary nerve. So in this diagram also you can appreciate this very well, that this is your ciliary ganglia. Now here you can see that there are only two routes you can appreciate. This is the short ciliary nerves, which are the connection between the eyeball and ciliary ganglia. Now this nasociliary nerve is having the fibers which are sympathetic fibers. And these sympathetic fibers are approaching the eyeball without passing through the ganglia. That means this nerve is now known as long ciliary nerve. So this will become the long ciliary nerve. And this connection is the short ciliary nerve. So the very basic thing which you have to understand, that if the fibers are passing through the ganglia to approach the eyeball, then it has to be the short ciliary nerve. If the fibers are passing without entering into the ganglia, then it has to be the long ciliary nerve. So what is the sympathetic supply effect? So whatever the pathway is there, the postganglionic sympathetic fiber reach the eyeball and they innervate the dilator pupillae and blood vessels of the eyeball. So what are the branches of ciliary ganglia? So ciliary ganglia give rise only one set of the branch, that is known as short ciliary nerve, and these are 8 to 10 in number. They contain fibers from all the three roots which I told you, or sometimes the sympathetic fibers may absent, then they will pass through the long ciliary nerve. So these nerve runs above and below the optic nerve towards the eyeball. When they are approaching the eyeball, they run all around the optic nerve. So on reaching the eyeball, they pierce the sclera around the attachment of the optic nerve itself, and then they passes forward in the space between the sclera and choroid to reach the target area of distribution. So now there is one more important concept which always asked in your exam, that what is the difference between the long ciliary nerve and short ciliary nerve. So long ciliary nerve is a branch of nasociliary nerve. Now this is the important thing which you have to understand, that nasociliary nerve gives the branch is known as long ciliary nerve, while the short ciliary nerve, I just told you, they are the branch of ciliary ganglia. So this is the first and most important difference. Whenever you are having the name short ciliary, it means it is a connection between the ciliary ganglia and eyeball. So that is known as short ciliary nerve. But when you are having the long ciliary nerve, it is a branch of nasociliary nerve which is going to the eyeball. Then the second thing is that long ciliary nerves never contain postganglionic parasympathetic fiber. This is the most favorite question, that long ciliary nerve never contain postganglionic parasympathetic fibers. Because postganglionic parasympathetic fibers, those are arising from ciliary ganglia, always enter into the short ciliary nerve. So you will find that long ciliary nerve generally carries the sensory fibers from the ciliary body and iris, and they may have the postganglionic sympathetic fibers to the dilator pupillae, but never parasympathetic. So what is the type of the fibers we will find in the short ciliary nerve? Short ciliary nerve, we have seen that they are having fibers of all the three roots. That means you will find the sensory fibers, you will find postganglionic sympathetic fibers, and the monopoly is that postganglionic parasympathetic fibers always approach to the eyeball via short ciliary nerve, never via long ciliary nerve. So this is the most and basic thing which you have to keep in mind. So now there are two important relations, or I should say the functions of the ciliary ganglia, that is pupillary light reflex and accommodation reflex. So what is pupillary light reflex? This reflex results a constriction of the pupil when the retina is exposed directly to a bright light. That means if somebody is putting the heavy light on your eye, there is a sudden mucus occurs, and it is not only on the same eye but also on the another eye. So the effect on the same eye is known as direct eye reflex, pupillary eye light reflex, and on the opposite eye it is known as consensual or indirect eye reflex. So when you will have the light, the afferent is carried by the optic nerve which is carrying the sense from the retina. Now when you are talking about the efferent of this reflex, the efferent or the motor reflex comes from the parasympathetic nuclei, that is known as Edinger-Westphal nucleus, which is present in the midbrain, and it is the fibers approaching to the ciliary ganglia via oculomotor nerve, where you will have the relay of the fibers and postganglionic fibers arises and enter into the short ciliary nerve, and they will supply the sphincter pupillae that is responsible for the constriction of pupil. Clear? But this is for the same eye. Now, why the opposite eye pupil also show the constriction? So, it is happen because of the connection in the midbrain, and that is responsible for the consensual light reflex. So, to understand this, you have to know about the connection between the pretectal nucleus and Edinger-Westphal nucleus. So, you have this midbrain section where you can see that there is a nuclei is known as pretectal nucleus. Now, this pretectal nucleus is having a bilateral connection in the midbrain. So, it is not only sending the efferent to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus of the same side, but it is also controlling or sending the efferent to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus of opposite side. So, because of this bilateral connection of this pretectal nuclei, what will happen? That it is receiving the afferents. So, afferents are sending from this optic nerve to the pretectal nuclei. From this pretectal nuclei, the efferents are going on both the side. So, not only the ciliary ganglia will show the parasympathetic stimulation in this eye, but also because of the stimulation of opposite side parasympathetic nuclei, it is also showing the parasympathetic effect on the opposite eye also. So, this is the only connection that is responsible for opposite eye light reflex. That means the pretectal nuclei is having the stimulation or efferents on bilateral Edinger-Westphal nucleus in the midbrain. So, this is the same thing is written here, that the fibers of pretectal nuclei reach the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, which is known as preganglionic parasympathetic, bilaterally. And this is the only reason that you will have the pupillary light reflex on the opposite eye also. Then you will have the accommodation reflex. Now, accommodation reflex means when a person try to focus on a nearby object after having focused on an object in the distance. What does it mean? That if you ask the patient to see a far away, and then suddenly you bring your eye, you bring your finger in between his nose and ask him to concentrate on your finger. So that is the change from the distance to your near object is showing the accommodation. Now this accommodation reflex is having a triad, or there are three components. One is whenever you ask the person to see from distance to the near object, there is a constriction of the pupil. Along with that, you need to increase the convexity of the lens. And third, there is a convergence, or I should say medial rotation of both the eyeball. So these are the three important factors or the components of this accommodation reflex. So why it happens that this reflex involves parasympathetic fibers? So it causes constriction of the pupil and stimulation of the contraction of ciliary muscle, causing the relaxation of the suspensory ligament of the lens. What does it mean? That when a person is looking far, at the time the lens is flat. But when a person need to see near object, then you need convexity of the lens. So this is the important thing which you have to understand, that when a person is looking far away, the lens is flat because of the tension in the suspensory ligament and relaxation of ciliary muscle. But when you have to look for the near object, you have to make the lens more convex, and it is the convexity is possible only when the suspensory ligament become relaxed and ciliary muscle contracts. So when there is a contraction of ciliary muscle with relaxation of suspensory ligament, the lens shows the convexity. So these are the two effects which you have to remember, that far object the lens is flat, but for the near object you need convexity of the lens. This result in more round lens, or I should say more convexity of the lens, and convergence of the eye occurs because your oculomotor nerve is also responsible, which is supplying medial rectus, superior rectus and inferior rectus, which all three causes the medial rotation on or convergence of eyeball. So at the end of this class, what we are able to understand, that what is ciliary ganglia, what are the three roots of the ciliary ganglia, if the sympathetic root is absent, then what are the alternate pathways, What is the difference between the short ciliary nerve and long ciliary nerve, and what is pupillary light reflex and accommodation reflex? So this is all for today's class. Thank you.